Welcome to the 3030 Health Podcast. The following discussion is for education and entertainment. It is not intended to diagnose or treat disease. Please do not apply any of this information without first discussing it with your doctor. Here is your host, Dr. Ruiz.
Hello, everyone. Super excited about this episode. My guest is Bridget Danner. Bridget has been a licensed acupuncturist since 2004 and a certified functional diagnostic practitioner since 2015. She has given over 12,000 treatments in her career. While running a busy integrative wellness center in Portland, Oregon, she developed an environmental illness due to toxic mold in her home. She became acutely aware of the powerful impact of the environment and health. I hope you enjoy the show. Hello, everyone. Super excited to be here with my friend, Bridget Danner. Bridget, how is it going?
Great. Really nice to come be a part of your community today.
Yeah, you know, it's pretty crazy, you know, with we had a pre-conversation. We're talking a little bit of viruses and bacteria. So my mind is kind of like in that realm right now. But I want to talk about detoxification. But before we begin our show, as usual, Bridget, what is your hero story? How did you get to become a practitioner and what brought you to this space?
What brought me into natural medicine was originally a concern I had for the environment. I was like a young environmentalist. I was always just concerned when I would hear about environmental issues on the news. And so that's how I got into natural living and, you know, got into like herbs and gardening. And my life path was kind of telling me, like, do something that's going to have a positive effect on the environment. So I originally studied art and some other things, but I went into acupuncture school with the idea that later I would teach classes like about the environment while I did health stuff. And, you know, that was sort of always my vision. I became a practicing Chinese medicine practitioner and got, you know, busy with my clinic and supporting people. And I was living in Portland, Oregon. It's already pretty environmentally aware. So to some extent, that went to the back burner, but it came back up to the front burner when I had my own environmental illness and had to learn about detox. And, you know, I wanted to talk more about detox and bring that into my practice more. So it was just sort of full circle that now talking about non-toxic living felt like more of a fit. So that's sort of my story, and, you know, sort of a personal interest first, and then like many people becoming sick made the focus a little different for me.
Well, you'd be happy to know that my New Year's resolution for this year was to not use any bags.
Oh, wow.
You know, you hear reduce, reuse, recycle. I guess people put them in the same category. But recycling really is not that effective.
No, especially nowadays.
Yeah, you know, we're sending a lot of this recycling in barges to China where it gets processed and then it gets brought back in barges. And, you know, we're just paying for a lot of carbon footprint. So the goal should be to reduce. Number one, reduce. And let's try to accumulate less plastic in our lives. Let's try to accumulate less everything, you know, you kind of feel like a little lighter.
Yeah. And, you know, here in the U.S., we're not doing as good of a job of it as other countries. Some countries are doing a lot more like bulk purchases where you bring your own containers to stores and have bulk things put into them. You know, living in Portland, I thought everyone was pretty aware of this. And then I moved to Phoenix, where you're also living. And I was like, whoa, people are still not very aware of all this stuff. So it really made me realize, yeah, there's still plenty of room to educate. Because, like, yeah, here in Phoenix, you know, if I go to Starbucks or if I go to the grocery store, majority of people are using a single-use coffee cup, like the vast majority. And then at the store, you know, sometimes at the store you see people bring their own bags, but lots of people do not ever bring their own bags. And it was pretty shocking to me.
Yeah, no, and when I made this decision, I didn't buy any new bags. You know, like, I was like, I will not buy any new bags. Whatever I have, that's what I'm going to use. And actually, this Saturday, I went to the grocery store, and I forgot my bags. And I told the cashier, I'm just going to have to carry it by hand. And, you know, I am going to not use any more bags. And that's my resolution. I stand by it. Now, I think the biggest mistake is going to Starbucks when you live in a place that has cartel coffee. Mm. Have you been to cartel?
Of it. I'm not a big like coffee drinker, so I've heard of it, but I don't think I've been there yet.
Okay, so we're gonna have to go for coffee, and I'm going to introduce you to cartel.
Okay, awesome. Yeah, I went to Press Coffee this morning, and she actually, that one's very good. She remembered to ask me. She said, "Do you want, or is it for here to go?" And I was like, "Thank you for asking. It's for here. I really appreciate, you know, giving me a proper coffee cup and not a to-go cup."
Yeah, no, in being able to detoxify your living, you know, your whole house, detoxifying your environment, and then even your friends and relationships, you know, it's just so important for so many reasons. Now, one thing that I hear a lot, and you'll read and, you know, and you'll find memes on social media, is that why do we need to detoxify if we have kidneys and a liver? So how do you answer that question?
Yeah, so our bodies do have systems to detoxify, for sure. But I think at any point in time, it's always good to support your detoxification, but especially in this point in time in history where we have all these man-made toxins that are put into our environment, we're all coming into contact with, you know, all the times, and we have more stimulation and more stress. But even if we just, you know, focus on environmental toxicants, you know, even if you're bringing your own bags and have like your green shampoo or whatever, we 100% are all still exposed. We run some urine toxin tests in my practice. And, you know, a lot of my clients have very clean living. They have their own water filters and all this stuff. And they're still testing high in like gasoline additives or styrenes or what have you. So we definitely all are carrying around toxins that are new to the body. Like we didn't have, you know, hundreds of years ago.
Now, you mentioned that you have some experience with mold toxicity.
Yes, and that is a natural toxin that is, you know, made by mold. However, the way we make our houses is very, like, how can you say, like, modern, right? So the why we become exposed to toxic mold, and, you know, because if you're just walking through the forest, you're not going to be, like, overcome by toxic mold illness. But in your own home with plumbing and drywall and all that, like, water can collect and mold can grow in places that's abnormal, and then you can become sick from these natural toxins of mold.
Now, this might be a little personal question, but was your move from Portland to Arizona driven by that?
It was, yeah. And even still, you know, it's just moving didn't make me better because I still had become so compromised in my health. But it definitely helped. I'm much happier to be living here in this dry environment. There is some mold still here in older buildings that I run into, but certainly a lot less. And so to get back to your question, yes, our bodies do detoxify. But if you're not putting in an optimal diet and information and you're overwhelmed by the amount of toxins you're exposed to, and maybe also like genetics aren't favorable or getting turned on in an unfavorable way, I'm very much a fan of supporting your detox systems every day in different little ways we can talk about, with just high quality diet and just the choices you make throughout the day.
So one of the things that I immediately, it was an easy fix, was like substituting my Tupperware for glass. That was easy. You know, I try not to drink from plastic bottles. Those are things that you won't miss and that are going to help, especially and I wasn't specifically concerned about toxicity, even though I should have been. I was more concerned about estrogens, you know, and me being a guy, you know, I want to have my testosterone levels as high as possible. What are some other things that are easy changes, easy fixes that we might not be thinking about that could improve our detox pathways, that would reduce the burden of toxicity?
Yeah, the three kind of low-hanging fruit I usually ask people to emphasize is, one, reducing plastic exposure, like you just said, and we could talk about more sources. The second would be reducing exposure to fragrance, artificial fragrance, and eating organic as much as possible. Those are like the three easiest, I think, to access. And they can make a really big difference on your toxic load.
I wasn't like uber aware of fragrances. Growing up in my house, you know, my mom, you would use that, you know, Fabuloso, you know, stuff that is overwhelming when you actually think about it, you know, or like plug-ins, you know, or like air fresheners. You know, I always, one of my favorite things to do was going to the store and like pick the best one, you know, and like, oh, my house is going to smell like, and I wasn't aware. And when I moved to Arizona, I kind of stopped using it, you know, and after a while, you're like, damn, you know, every time I walk into a house or a place, office building that has these fragrances, you notice it.
Yeah, and there's many people who aren't aware of the fragrance issue and are just kind of swimming in it all day. It's in their deodorant, it's in their scented trash can liners, it's in their kitty litter, and it's just a cocktail of chemicals. It's getting stirred up. It very much can be a lung irritant, but it's also a hormone disruptor and an obesogen, which means it's like a chemical compound that can affect the way that you gain or lose weight, which nobody wants. So I think there's so many people out there who feel like, why am I overweight, or why are my hormones so whacked out? And they aren't looking at this like everyday exposure to toxins. And reducing fragrance will often just get you into a category of products that are generally cleaner. So if it's a good clean product that is aware of fragrance and uses essential oils instead, it's probably the whole formula is going to be cleaner than the Fabuloso. I mean, who knows what's in the Fabuloso?
That's the scent of my childhood. Now, okay, so those are easy. You know, you start getting into a little bit of like a territory of like, well, you know, now I can't use fabric softener. I used to love fabric softener, and after, you know, a couple of years of not using it, I don't miss it anymore. At the beginning, it was rough, but, you know, I don't miss it anymore. And again, now that's one less bottle of something that I'm buying. You know, that's reducing. So,
true.
You know,
definitely.
For me, instead of trying to use something that was natural that might not work as well, and I'm like, ugh, you know, like, I can just buy the cheaper stuff and it works better, I just stop using it, and that's it. But what about like the tough stuff? You know, what about like people that you know, have like special hair requirements or deodorant? You know, I'm yet to find a deodorant that doesn't have aluminum that works for me.
Yeah, and sometimes that can take some trial and error. Or if you're switching out makeup, a lot of people get nervous about that one because they have stuff that they really feel like works for them. You know, one makeup company I like a lot is Beauty Counter, and they will let you return stuff if it's like not the right color for you or whatever. So that's an option. Particular hair needs, they have a whole line of hair care, which I'm really happy with. You know, Whole Foods and stuff has a lot of those specialty products as well. I don't know their return policy. Personally, for deodorant, I'm going to share my favorite. It contains zinc. And some people are asking me, well, is that like bad for you in some other way? I'm not seeing it. Maybe you can weigh in. But it seems to have a similar effect with aluminum of like being long lasting. So I use this Now brand, like long lasting deodorant, and it has zinc and not aluminum. And I just found this like cedarwood scent that is really lovely. I think men or women could use it. So I'm just sharing because it's my favorite. And I've done all my experiments with deodorant like over the years. This is my hands down favorite, and you can find it on Amazon.
Yeah, no, I've tried deodorants, and the last one that I tried was like a rose water scent one. And I broke out in a rash. So I'm like, oh, yeah, that's the one thing that I still haven't, you know, completely found something that works. You know, I was in Florida just recently, and I ended up using, you know, mosquito repellent that was full of chemicals, because I would rather not get sick than use something that is not going to work. But I'm sure there's things out there that work really well.
Well, yeah, and sometimes we've gotten used to these chemical deodorants that work like amazing, right? And we don't smell like ever. And we're also kind of backed up with like toxins in our armpits. So some people, we have somewhere on our site, like you can do like a clay mask, like an armpit detox with clay and apple cider vinegar and maybe tea tree or something. you know, one way we detox is through sweat, right? So if we've been repressing that for many, many years, and now we're going natural, sometimes you can be even stinkier in the beginning. You're generally stinkier when you're going through a detox period. I don't know if you've noticed that, like, there's times where you're just like a lot stinkier than others. And that kind of detox sweating can be stinkier, I find.
It's like a two-way street. You know, like, for example, my poop smells less now that I eat in this paleo style, you know, format, you know, with eating less processed things, you know. And I think that the cleaner you are, the more efficient you are, you won't need as much deodorant.
Yes. Over time, you won't be as stinky.
Yeah.
I think that's true.
In every way, you know, it, like, less gassy, you know, your urine doesn't smell as bad. Your poops don't smell as bad. And, you know, Chinese medicine, you know, as a naturopath, I get training in Chinese medicine. You know that all of those things matter. You know, the Chinese call, you know, dampness, and poop, it should smell bad. You know, you're not going to eat it, but it shouldn't be toxic. You know, you shouldn't be having to spray the fauloso or whatever after you go to the bathroom. You know, it just doesn't make sense for our body to be that toxic. And I notice it with myself that if I get cross-contaminated with, you know, with bad foods, or if I haven't been my, you know, my best self with my diet, I can notice that, the you know, even my stool changes for the worse. And as I get more into a healthier diet, you know, it goes back to, you know, pooping snakes, you know, and using less toilet paper and all of those things that happen when your body is working optimally.
Yeah. And some people ask me, like, what are signs that I'm toxic? And you're kind of giving some examples here with digestion and odor. But there's so many signs. And I think, unfortunately, for most kind of mainstream folks, like, they're just all having the symptoms so constantly, they don't even really sort them through. But, like, headaches, sore joints, skin breakouts, like, kind of a bloating, or like lymph congestion, you know, can't lose weight. And then there's these other kind of things that seem deeper, but can still be very much due to toxicity, like your periods being irregular, or low sex drive, or man boobs from the estrogens in the food. So there's all these little signs, actually, that you're toxic. And I appreciate that a lot of these overlap with other things. But, like, identifying some of them and just kind of identifying where you're off and thinking about the toxins in your house, or other ways that you could be exposed to toxins. We talked a bit about mold. You and I were talking about gut infections, you know, off air. And, you know, just investigating, because it's not normal to be sore all the time, or to, you know, need to, like, reapply some maximum deodorant 3 times a day. So just, yeah, like, looking at, like, where would you like things to, you know, flow easier in your health, and what could potentially be behind it.
So what's your triage method? You know, do you start with, you know, let's start with the house, let's start with your products, let's start with, you know, diet? How do you go about making someone less toxic?
So in our community, folks are usually already pretty good on their diet in their home, which makes my life a lot easier. So we do some interviews and publishing about, like, you know, people have some high level questions, like picking out a water filter, and we do some writing about that kind of a thing. But I'm fortunate that my community is really covered a lot of their bases already, which is great, and it's going to reduce symptoms. But then sometimes there's things beyond that. Like, this is like me when I found out I had toxic mold. I was actually going to a naturopathic college, and I'm like, you know what, I really can't get better with my habits here. Like, I'm really doing a good job, and I shouldn't be this exhausted, and I shouldn't be, you know. So you've done those basic things, cleaned up your home, cleaned up your act with your diet, you're going to bed on time, like, you're doing new things, and you're still having symptoms that are really troubling you and don't seem to have an explanation, I would definitely consider toxins. We're finding plenty of people who are dealing with toxic mold, you know, do have toxins in their body. Is it the only factor? No, they usually also have some gut infection, or, you know, some other things going on. So in our business, our online business, we offer some testing, and we just kind of let people pick where they want to start. We kind of educate about options, testing your hormones, testing for toxins, et cetera. And we kind of let people choose. So some people go that route and we review the results with them and give them recommendations. And then some, we teach a lot about just DIY detox and kind of like self-led detox you can do. Like, I'm a big fan of sauna and dry brushing and castor oil packs. So a lot of that stuff is tolerable and healthy for most people and gives you that, you know, that boost to detox, even if you don't exactly know what's going on. You know, just using a sauna is, you know, good for most anybody.
Are you familiar with Ari Whitten?
Yeah, I love Ari.
Yeah, so he posted something on Facebook earlier this year that people say that sweating is just, that's it. That's what the benefits of sauna are, you know, just that you sweat. And I kind of was in that camp. I was like, I would tell people, well, as long as you sweat, it doesn't really matter. But he showed me a couple of papers showing that the hormetic effect of the heat on the skin is also causing some changes in protein synthesis, and that helps you detoxify better. So there is more benefit to sauna than just the heat, you know, because like living in Arizona, it's easy for us to sweat, but being in a controlled environment where we are raising our body temperature to a certain degree and then backing off rapidly from it does have other effects than just sitting outside with a margarita sweating.
You know? So benefits.
Yeah, that has other benefits. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, no, I'm in Arizona and I actually love the heat and I love like getting some sweat on and getting the sun on my skin. But I also have a sauna here, which I use a little more in the winter than the summer. Because yeah, when you're relaxed and sweating, it's a little different. There are studies on it. So yeah, sometimes I hear that argument, well, can't you just sweat? But like working out like on a treadmill at the gym, sweating is a different kind of sweating than relaxing in a sauna. There's a lot of, so many benefits to sauna usage.
Yeah, I think the biggest benefit is that acute input of heat on the skin, you know, because if you're just outside sweating, you know, your body, it's not a rapid change where you are changing, you know, how your body is reacting. It would be like the difference between someone that walks a lot, they walk every day, versus someone that trains with sprinting, you know, and saying, oh, you know, walking a lot will translate into making you a better sprinter. Well, no, sprinting will make you a better sprinter. And walking is phenomenal. It you know, everyone should walk as much as possible. But if you want to activate those muscle fibers, and if you want to build muscle, and if you want to have that explosiveness, adding sprinting to your walking regimen is going to make you a better human. So same thing with like just sweating. Sweating is important, and you should sweat, and you should exercise. But having that acute input of a higher temperature actually trains your body to become a better detoxifier. That was very interesting take on that, because I was on the camp of, oh, just sweating and that's all you need.
Yeah, your body, well, there's so many benefits, like I said, but you know, your body becomes kind of more adaptable to when you're exposed to that high heat, just like exposed to high cold. I've been doing some cryotherapy here in Phoenix and that's been really fun to experiment with as well. So yeah, there's so many practices and, you know, some of them can be expensive, but I don't say you have to start out with like a Cadillac sauna. You know, you can have your 24-hour fitness membership or whatever it is and just go to that sauna, you know, and is it as fancy and stuff? No, maybe not, but like you're getting sweating, you're getting sauna use, you're seeing if, how you like it, you know, before you make a big investment, especially when I was displaced from having toxic mold. I certainly wasn't going to buy a sauna or could afford a sauna then. And I just went to gyms and it was one of the most helpful things for me. It was like top three most helpful things for me when I was at my sickest. So yeah, I'm a big fan of that. And again, like whether you know for sure you've got toxic mold or something, or you just are like, you know, I think most people know they need to detox. They just like have a sense of it, right? They're just like, ugh, I kind of feel like I'm just carrying around some stuff I shouldn't be. Just supporting that system and making that choice. I'm also thinking like lemon water or different little simple green drinks that are easy to make. And so, yeah, we teach a lot about just like basic practices and good habits that go beyond that myth, like, oh, like we don't need to support detox. It's like, well, yeah, we do, and we can. It's just like eating. Like, we can put stuff in our mouth to give us calories, or we can put stuff in our mouth to really give us nutrition and feed ourselves. And obviously, we want to do the latter. And kind of same with detox choices or non-toxic living choices. Like, if we give our body the best input and the most support, our body's going to respond in kind, and we're going to have more energy and sleep better and manage weight better. And your skin looks better. And these are all things people want.
What do you tell patients that feel worse after detoxing?
Oh yeah. So I'm a big fan of not feeling worse. I don't think it's like more pain, more gain, but sometimes you hit that level, right? Some people can hardly sauna. They can only go in for 5 minutes. Now, a lot of people we work with have multiple diagnoses. They've become like very sensitive to supplements. So there are some people who really can do very little. And I still encourage them to do, you know, what they can, even if it's just like a half capsule of a binder every other day, because that's all they can tolerate. Or experimenting with various therapies, like maybe coffee enema is too intense for you, but you could do red light therapy, and that's doing some healing for you too, but it's, you know, not as jarring for your system. So it really depends on your own system. Like, I'm very tolerant of detox techniques, but I'm like a little sensitive, like gut supplements. I did some chelation therapy. That was way too much for me. So we're all different, but I don't think it should be, you know, horrible. That if you feel worse, the toxins are recirculating and you're not able to clear them. So there is, it's definitely not more pain, more gain. You're actually re-toxifying yourself if you feel worse.
Yeah, so, what I say is you got to detox, not retox.
Exactly. Yeah. So if you're doing more advanced detox, working with a practitioner and kind of finding your balance, if you're listening and you've been on this path a while, like, you know what I'm talking about. Like, you kind of like find your own edge. And I feel really a lot for the people who are super sensitive and can barely tolerate anything. But, you know, you just have to, there's a lot of options out there, and you just kind of have to experiment and find what works for you, and going super low dose may be just as effective as the person who can high dose. It's just we all have a different dose.
We do a lot of heavy metal detox with chelation. You know, do you know what type of chelator agents they were using on you?
It was a couple of years ago, so I don't totally remember, but I think it was just like the common one. Is that like EDTA or what is that called?
Yeah, EDTA, yeah. And people just are so aggressive with EDTA or DMSA or DMPS, you know, and they are so aggressive with it, and they don't provide full support. And when you have something like EDTA or DMPS, you know, it has an affinity towards like lead, or it has an affinity towards mercury, but it also chelates zinc, it also chelates selenium, it also chelates calcium. You know, EDTA is also used for like removing calcium plaques, you know, from the heart. And when you don't provide support, you know, when doing these types of modalities, you know, that's when you hear people saying, oh my goodness, you know, you basically liberated all of these bad chemicals into my body. And then if your detox pathways are not working and you are not getting rid of the things, you know, so it creates this storm. And I have seen a lot of patients that get so much better after doing some gentle chelation. You know, I have a patient who had porphyria, which is a problem with your red blood cells where they're not forming properly. She grew up in a house that used clay pots, and all of her life, you know, had fatigue, had, you know, so many different problems. And then we worked with her and we figured out that the next step in, was chelation. And we chelated her lead and now her red blood cells are perfect. And it's been 2 years now and her genetic condition of porphyria has resolved. Unfortunately, there's a lot of practitioners that are not very careful with the way they do metal chelation. And there are horror stories, just like, you know, people that have mercury amalgams, you know, and then they go to their neighborhood dentist and they take them out and you release a bunch of mercury into their bloodstream because they didn't do the appropriate extraction method, okay? So then they have these really bad reactions, and now they're suffering more than if they had left those metals in place. So knowing, you know, going to someone that knows what they're doing with chelation is very important. And then supporting those detox pathways with awesome things like glutathione, vitamin C, and replenishing minerals is very important with chelation, because some things that might feel like detox or retox might be dehydration. You know, might be that your minerals are so low that now you feel like crap because you don't have any salt in your body, you know? So being able to have a person that knows what they're doing whenever, you know, they do chelation is very, very, very important.
Yeah, I agree. And we talked a bit off air about this, that, you know, based on your health history, everybody's going to respond differently to different things. And so some of the stuff we sell in our supplement store, you know, can be really strong for certain people. So it's tricky and people can get frustrated. And then when you talk about things like IV chelation, now we're getting really strong. And you do need supervision. I mean, this is why, you know, we offer consultations with the labs and we offer lab reviews and supplement reviews to try to give people that option. Like, if you need a second opinion, if you need some advice on how to do this, you know, we're here for you. And then we just try to also just provide a lot of education about options. So the more educated you are before you go into something, the better, because hopefully you know your body. I will tell you my IV horror story. He didn't tell me he did chelation the first time he did it. And I was sick as a dog for like 3 to 5 days, like just a constant headache. And I was just super inflamed. So I went back and I was like, yeah, that really sucks. And he was like, oh yeah, we chelated you and we'll do half this time. And I was like, well, I guess. Okay. But I felt so bad. And the second time was just as bad. So I didn't go back, you know, and it just, you know, it definitely leaves a bad taste in your mouth to, like, you know, get so sick.
Did you ever get measured to see if you even had heavy metals?
No, it was more like, I think his theory was more like, well, when you're toxic with mold, like you're kind of toxic with like a lot of stuff and just like, you know, generally detoxing.
Yeah, but, you know, at the same time, would you want to use this medications that can chelate good metals if you don't have any bad metals? So you know, it's like test don't guess. And yeah, so and this is the type of stuff where you hear all these horror stories about people that are going through chelation therapy and they get really bad results because people don't respect our medicine, you know. And it's one of those things that in our practice, you know, we do some heavy metal testing and chelation. And we are in a place where we might stop doing it because that's not our hill to die on, you know, because there's so many people doing it wrong that we don't want people to believe that we're going to do something bad for them because we offer this chelation. So this is something that we might be facing out completely. And it's such a powerful modality, because what we care about as a naturopathic endocrinologist, what we want is to make sure that your immune system is working well and your hormones are working well. And we are willing to battle in that battle, you know, and metal detoxification can be a very useful tool. But it's a tool that should be used rarely and should be used with a lot of respect.
That's a great point. And yeah, I don't want to, I guess more than anything, I want to just give an example of like everybody has their limit and like kind of finding, because I've done a ton of other things that I've tolerated super, super well. And we have to have some knowledge of ourselves and our background and our practitioners that we're working with to make the best choices. And even still, sometimes they're going to push it too far when we're trying to detox and, you know, may end up with a headache or constipated or whatever. And then that's just, you know, information that we went a little too far.
Where can people find you? How can people get a hold of you? What's your social media?
Sure. So my main site is my name. It's BridgetDanner.com. And I'm on Instagram the most actively, and that's Hormone Detox Shop.
Awesome. Awesome. Such a pleasure to have you. And I hope that, you know, that we continue with this battle, you know, and trying to help people be less toxic.
Yeah. Thanks for your support on that.
Thank you so much. And I'll talk to you soon.